Hey there, welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to discuss regarding the pacemaker potential. In order to understand the pacemaker potential, you also have to understand the action potential which is generated in a cardiac muscle. So please watch that video. The link for that video I will leave in the description. Watch first that video and then come back to the pacemaker potential. Okay, so let's start with the pacemaker potential. As you are seeing here in the diagram, the pacemaker potential is looking entirely different from that of the action potential which was generated in the cardiac muscle. So what is pacemaker? We all say pacemaker is sinoatrial node. But do we know why sinoatrial node is called as the pacemaker? Sinoatrial node is called as the pacemaker because of the two reasons. What is the first reason? The first reason is that sinoatrial node is having the capacity to develop or generate the impulses on its own. What is this called as? This is what is called as automaticity. Okay, automaticity. And when this automaticity, and it is generating the impulses on its own, and also it is generating the impulses rhythmically. So that is called as rhythmicity. And when we combine both of them, it is called as autorhythmicity. So that is not the only reason why sinoatrial node is called as the pacemaker, but sinoatrial node is also generating the impulses at the highest rate. That is what is very important, because almost even the atrioventricular node and the bundle of His, even the Purkinje fibers, they are also having that property in them by which they can generate the impulses on their own. But it is the sinoatrial node which is generating the impulses at the highest rate, and it is generating the impulses on its own. That is why sinoatrial node is called as the pacemaker. Okay, fine. Now let's see the action potential in a cardiac muscle and what are the few differences in the action potential in a cardiac muscle compared with that of the pacemaker potential. As we have already discussed this video, action potential in a cardiac muscle is having so many different phases. Phase 0 is there, phase 1 is there, phase 2 is there, phase 3 is there, and phase 4 is there. Phase 4 is nothing but the resting membrane potential. But what has happened here? There is only phase 0, that is the phase of depolarization. Remember, there is no phase 1 or phase 2. And then we have the phase 3, which is the phase of repolarization. And then we have the phase 4, which is the resting membrane potential. So that means there is no phase 1 and there is no phase 2. Now, with respect to resting membrane potential, how much was the resting membrane potential in a cardiac muscle? Yeah, do you remember? I told you it was somewhere between minus 85 to minus 90 millivolt. But how much is the resting membrane potential here? The resting membrane potential in case of the sinoatrial node is somewhere between minus 55 millivolts to minus 60 millivolts. But remember, this resting membrane potential is not stable. This resting membrane potential fluctuates. That's why the resting membrane potential in SA node is said to be unstable. So why I am telling it as unstable? As you are seeing here, once the resting membrane potential has touched to minus 60 millivolts, what is happening to the membrane potential? The membrane potential is slowly depolarizing, and this membrane potential is slowly coming and hitting the threshold level. What is the threshold level here? The threshold level is minus 40 millivolt. So this slow depolarization of the resting membrane potential, okay, which is leading to the generation of the next impulse, is what is called as pacemaker potential. So now here we are there to study as to what is the reason behind this pacemaker potential. And remember, this slow depolarization process is not happening because of any external factor. It is happening on its own because of some channels which are present in the sinoatrial node. So we will see what are those channels and what are those ions which are responsible for this slow depolarization, which is bringing the potential back to the threshold level and helping in generation of the next impulse on its own. Okay, so to understand that, we will start with the third phase. What was the third phase here? The third phase was the phase of repolarization. Like anywhere else, the repolarization in the SA node is also going to happen basically because of the potassium efflux. A positive ion from inside is going outside. What is happening to the inside of the cell? Inside of the cell is becoming negative, and that is leading to a fall in the membrane potential. And then the membrane potential comes around minus 60 to minus 55 millivolts. once the membrane potential decreases to minus 55 to minus 60. So that's the first point. Okay, once it decreases to minus 60 millivolts, there is activation or there is opening of slow sodium channels. Opening of slow sodium channels. And these sodium channels are very special sodium channels. They are called as F channels or they are also called as H channels. Okay, why they are called as F channels? Because these are funny sodium channels. And why they are called as H channels? Because these are the sodium channels which are opening during hyperpolarization. Okay, these are unusual sodium channels. Usually the sodium channels will open during the process of depolarization, but here these are the sodium channels which are opening during the time of hyperpolarization, that is when the membrane is becoming more and more negative. Okay, and these are the slow sodium channels. So opening of the sodium channels is going to cause sodium influx. It is going to cause a sodium influx. So once a positive ion now slowly starts entering into the cell, what is going to happen to the membrane potential? Membrane potential is going to become less negative. So now what happens? Slowly the membrane potential, slowly it starts to become less negative and it reaches to somewhere around minus 50 millivolts. Okay, so this is the reason for the first part of the pacemaker potential. Now once it hits, so that's now I'm going to the second point. Once the membrane potential hits around minus 50 millivolts, now there is opening of one more channel which is called as T calcium channels. Now again here, what does T stands for? T here is standing for transient calcium channel. So whenever there is opening of this transient, means these are open for very short amount of time. They open and then they again close. So transient calcium channel opens, what is going to happen? There is going to be a calcium influx. Again, calcium being a positive ion is coming inside the cell and it is moving this membrane potential to minus 40 millivolts, which is the firing level or the threshold level. Okay, so that means the first part of the pacemaker potential is because of sodium influx, which has happened because of opening of the F sodium channels, and the second part of the pacemaker potential is occurring because of the calcium influx, which has occurred because of opening of the T calcium channels or the transient calcium channels. Once the membrane potential hits, that's the third point, minus 40 millivolts, there is opening of one more type of calcium channel, which is called as L calcium channel. So L means long lasting calcium channels. So once the long lasting calcium channels are open, there is rapid influx of calcium. So this rapid influx of the calcium is what is responsible for the phase zero or the phase of depolarization. One more difference between action potential which is generated in an SN node and action potential which is generated in the cardiac muscle is this. The phase zero of the action potential, which is a rapid depolarization phase, in case of a cardiac muscle was because of which ions? It was because of the sodium ions. But in case of cardiac muscle, it is purely because of the influx of the calcium. Okay, so once the action potential is generated, again at the peak of the action potential, there is closure of this calcium channels, which is the L-type calcium channels, and now there is opening of the potassium channels leading to potassium efflux, and again there is process of repolarization, and this process keeps on repeating again and again and again and again, and this is how our SN node is able to generate impulse on its own, and this is the basis of the pacemaker potential. Okay, our answer when we are answering this question in our exams is not going to end here, because we have to add what is the effect of sympathetic and parasympathetic stimulation on the pacemaker potential. So now let's see here in this diagram, this is one action potential or the pacemaker potential. This is the second and this is the third. What we have done here is we have done a sympathetic stimulation. So once there is a sympathetic stimulation, I want you to concentrate on this line because this line is the pacemaker potential. See this line here and see this line here. So what is the difference? What has happened here? The slope of the pacemaker potential has increased. Once the slope of the pacemaker potential has increased, the threshold is reached earlier. So once the threshold is reached earlier, the action potential is generated earlier. So now here you are seeing the duration between this impulse and this impulse is more, but the duration between this impulse and this impulse is less. Why has that occurred? Because sympathetic stimulation is going to increase the slope of pacemaker potential. Okay, it is going to increase the slope of pacemaker potential. So what is going to happen? Impulses will be generated within a short duration of time. That is, the duration between the two impulses will be shortened. And what does that lead to? That lead to an increase in the heart rate. Okay, so sympathetic stimulation is going to cause an increase in the slope of the pacemaker potential, thus increasing the heart rate. If you want to still add something to this answer, then you can also write that the sympathetic stimulation is going to release a neurotransmitter which is called as norepinephrine. And this norepinephrine is going to act on the beta 1 receptor which is present in the SA node. So this action of norepinephrine on the beta 1 receptor is going to cause what? It is going to stimulate the calcium channels. Okay, it is going to stimulate the calcium channels. Once there is stimulation or facilitation of the calcium channels, there is more amount of calcium influx. And more amount of calcium influx is causing an increase in the slope of the pacemaker potential, thus increasing the heart rate. Now, let's see in a similar way as to what is happening when there is a vagal stimulation or a parasympathetic stimulation. As you are seeing here, what is happening to the pacemaker potential slope? The pacemaker potential slope has reduced. So, if the pacemaker potential slope has reduced, what has happened to the duration between these two impulses? The duration between the two impulses has increased. So what does that mean? That means what is going to happen to the heart rate? The heart rate is going to reduce. So sympathetic stimulation increased the slope of the pacemaker potential, thus increasing the heart rate, and the parasympathetic stimulation decreased the slope of the pacemaker potential, thus delaying the next threshold level, thus decreasing the heart rate. Again, if you want to add up to this, what you can do is you should write that the vagal stimulation is going to release acetylcholine as a neurotransmitter, and this acetylcholine neurotransmitter is acting on M2 receptor. Here M means muscarinic receptor, M2 receptor. So its action on the M2 receptor is going to cause increased conductance of potassium channels. Okay, once there is increased conductance of the potassium channels, what is going to happen? There is going to be a potassium efflux. But what should happen in the first part and the second part of the pacemaker potential? The first part of the pacemaker potential is because of the sodium influx. The second part of the pacemaker potential is because of the calcium influx. Okay. So on one side, positive ions are coming inside, and on another side, because of the sympathetic stimulation, a positive ion is going outside. So there is some kind of a balance occurring between the positive ions. That is why the pacemaker potential slope is low here. It is not rising rapidly. Okay. It takes more time for the pacemaker to go and hit the threshold level. And once it hits the threshold level, there is opening of the long-lasting calcium channels, and there is a rapid influx of calcium which is occurring, which overtakes the potassium efflux, and that is generating the action potential. Okay, so this is how we should understand the effect of sympathetic and parasympathetic stimulation on the pacemaker potential. So let's just summarize what all we have read. The membrane potential, in case of the pacemaker, it is going to move on its own to the firing level. How much was the firing level? The firing level was 5 - 40 millivolts. How much was the resting membrane potential? Resting membrane potential was -55 millivolts to -60 millivolts. So from here it is moving to -40. That is what is happening here. See, from here it moves to -40. Okay, so this is what is called as pacemaker potential, or it is also called as prepotential. Remember, there is one more name for this. I have told you two names. One is pacemaker potential and another one is prepotential. Find out the third name and tell me the third name in the comment section below. Next, two important events are happening at -60 millivolts. There is opening of the funny sodium channels leading to sodium influx. This is dragging the membrane potential to -50. Once the membrane potential comes to -50, there is opening of the transient calcium channels resulting in calcium influx. So sodium influx is responsible for first part of the pacemaker potential, and the calcium influx is what is responsible for the second part of the pacemaker potential. And never forget writing the effect of sympathetic and parasympathetic stimulation. Sympathetic stimulation increases the heart rate by increasing the slope of the prepotential, and parasympathetic stimulation decreases the heart rate by decreasing the slope of the prepotential. If you also want to add how does that occur, I have already described it. Okay, so as easy as this is how pacemaker potential is. If you have understood the concept of the pacemaker potential, hit the like button, subscribe to my video, and share the knowledge as much as possible. Thanks a lot. See you again.